Okay, guys, we are going to give this one more shot. I tried to film this video like 5 times this morning, and then it got too late. I like to make it to the rehab place before my mom has lunch because otherwise I don't 100% know if she's actually eating or not. So, anyway, the people across the street are doing construction, and it literally sounded like they were jackhammering, and then my phone rang in the middle of it. I'm just gonna put that on silent right now, so that I can make sure it doesn't do that, and then I'm gonna put it here next to me. Anyway, so this is part 2 of the crimes of Randy Taylor, and it is about Samantha Clarke. This case, I couldn't find a lot of information about it. I found one article that is from her. My dog is chewing on herself. Hey, quit that. It was an ink pen. I didn't hurt her. She chews herself till she cries because she has no concept of, oh, hey, this freaking hurts, like a dummy. So anyway, I found one really good article with actual details about Samantha and her life and, you know, things that she'd been doing and things like that. And whereas I found like 15 or 20 articles that I pieced together for Alexis, and it's kind of the opposite of what it normally is. Alexis is an African-American minority, you know, and Samantha is a Caucasian teenager. So usually it's the other way around, and that's why I try to pick like cases that I haven't heard of and things like that, which I know I've told you a dozen times, is because I want you guys to know these not worldwide known cases. Like Natalie Holloway, everybody's heard of that case, everybody knows her face, but there are so many other people that deserve to have their stories told. Although I've been thinking about doing a couple famous ones because I haven't seen any other artists do it. I have been obsessed with the Chris and Shanann Watts case and the mystery theory did it, and I loved it. But she, and I hope she doesn't update, so if you're watching, I would love to see that, didn't get the end of the story. And then ASMR Goldie did it. But, you know, there are still so many. I could talk about it forever because I've read so many articles. So, that one and Jodi Arias and Travis Alexander. I could talk about that one for a while. Anyway, we're going to talk about Samantha Clarke today. And we're going to talk about why Randy case in the hours before she disappeared, and she is clearly not around to answer questions, so he's really the only one that knows why, and we'll talk about what he says. So September 13th, 2010 was an otherwise ordinary Monday night for Samantha. She had graduated from Orange County High School 3 months earlier, and she spent the summer hanging out with her friends, posting on Facebook, and studying for her driver's license so that she could go get a job. According to her mom, she was getting herself together and trying to figure out what she wanted to do with her life. Samantha and her then 13-year-old brother Hunter were home alone that evening. They lived on Lindsay Drive, which was a quiet street about half a mile south of historic downtown Orange, and their mother worked the night shift at a tool manufacturing plant. Around 12:30 a.m., her mother, whose name is Barbara, said that her name is Barbara Tender, so I tried to change their names, but Barbara said that her cell phone received two phone calls from her home phone, but she was not allowed to use her phone while she was on duty. My dog is such a spaz. Anyway, so when she took a break around 1:30, she saw the missed phone calls on her phone, and she called home. She spoke with Hunter, who had been asleep, and he said that his sister, I have no idea what she's doing, his sister called upstairs sometime earlier, not sure at the exact time, and told him that she would be back. So the mom figured that Samantha had gone out with some new friends that she had made over the weekend. But the next morning came and went, and then the afternoon came and went. So Barbara started to get frantic. The two women shared a cell phone, so she had the cell phone, so she couldn't call Samantha to try to find her. And really, with these new friends, didn't have any way to try to find these people. The one thing I couldn't find is it ocean expedition. I don't know what kind of date that is, but I don't think it sounds very fun. Anyway, so she accepted the invitation and was soon saying that man number two, who was 23, was her boyfriend. Man number two had a girlfriend. And while Samantha was excited about the prospect of a relationship, her mom said that Samantha told her that she and this other girl, the other girlfriend, had already had some kind of confrontation. And Samantha told Barb that they jumped her, but that she couldn't see any injuries on her daughter, and says that Samantha was reluctant to provide any details of this alleged assault, which Barb thinks happened either Monday morning or early afternoon. So apparently, Randy Taylor says that he heard man number two and his girlfriend talking about what a tramp Samantha was, and they were going to beat her up, and they were going to do this and that and whatever, and this is why he called screws that held it in place gone. The wire that led to it had been cut. But the weirdest thing about it was Randy had just worked on his car the week before, so obviously it wasn't like that then. And he found a GPS unit underneath his car. He took it out, took the batteries out of it, and put it in the safe at his job. He was working at the used car lot, which I mentioned in the video before, at this time. So apparently, at this point in time in 2010, it wasn't illegal to track somebody without a warrant to put the device in place. He photographed the GPS and then, like I said, put it in the safe. In less than 24 hours, 10 cops showed up at his job. They never said that they were law enforcement. They just wanted the device back, said that it was a $3,800 unit, and they wanted it back. Randy conferred with a lawyer, and, you know, the lawyer agreed, give it back, but make them sign a receipt for it. Well, the guys that they sent refused to sign a receipt. They didn't want to sign for it because they didn't want a paper trail. But, you know, all the charges got dropped. The sheriff's deputies, they all went to court. The sheriff's deputies, you know, gave different varying stories. And the judge was like, it doesn't matter how you evaluate it. There's no credible evidence to support the warrantless search and seizure of Mr. Taylor's car. Now remember, this guy thinks that the police are trying to frame him, or claims that the police are trying to frame him. So it wasn't until the Supreme Court's ruling in January that said that a GPS requires a warrant, so no charges could be pressed for that. If they had done it the right way, then the charges probably would have stuck. So he said that the police scrutiny of him began long before he was arrested, 7 months after Samantha Clarke disappeared. He was claiming, and, you know, they're never going to admit whether it's true or not, that an Orange County detective, Okerson, would show up at his house, show up at his workplace multiple times in a day, that he would show up at restaurants where he was eating in other towns, and maybe when you're guilty or you have a guilty conscience, you start to think that people are harassing you or out to get you, or, you know, it's a small town, it's not a big town, maybe you're just running into this guy, I don't know. You'll have to let me know what you think. So they showed up at his house with a search warrant, and they found, and I quote, a tiny piece of marijuana, and said that it was enough to field test. Mr. Taylor insists that he doesn't do marijuana, doesn't do it, smoke it, whatever. But I don't know, I've never done it, so I have no idea. He was coerced into signing a form, some kind of form that said that if he signed it and said that they found it in his house, that they wouldn't arrest him. And 362 days later, he was served with an arrest warrant for a pot charge. He had been pulled over multiple times for alleged driving infractions, told that his license was suspended even after he got it reinstated. I think that's kind of weird. I mean, obviously, they're trying to find someone. His attorney said that he's usually a skeptic when it comes to claims of police misconduct. But he is quoted to say, I've had a lot of people tell me they've been framed by the police, and usually it's a crock. He said that he became convinced that Randy was telling the truth. Everything that he's told me has fit. They wanted to get him for anything. What worries me is that they're going so overboard. If they can't find a crime, they will invent one. Bartender She says she's barely hanging on. She still lives in the same apartment where pictures of Samantha cover the walls. And the wall actually has a message that says, "Still missing." "The police won't tell me anything," says Barbara. She's had another baby since Samantha's been gone. She says that Randy Taylor told her that he was trying to warn Samantha to stay away from the second man and his girlfriend. Barbara said she made contact with the second man and the girlfriend, who took her and her sister to see a lakefront community where Randy kept a camper. We've talked about this camper before, remember? And where they said he would sometimes hold parties. And while the couple didn't say that Taylor had harmed Samantha, the implication was that he played a part in her disappearance. Barbara feels like her body's in the lake. In the months following Samantha's disappearance, news reports revealed investigators searched the Green Acres subdivision and had divers search the lake on multiple occasions. But if they found anything to suggest that Samantha had been there, they're not saying. Randy says that to the best of his knowledge, Samantha had never been there. But the second man and his girlfriend were familiar with it. Randy contends that the duo know far more about Samantha's whereabouts than they've told investigators. I don't know really what to believe in this case. Randy Taylor says that he has experienced many losses in the wake of her disappearance, to include the custody of his son, who went to live with his mother after police allegedly warned him that his arrest was imminent. His job, a loss he attributes to police visits to his employer, and even his home.